Hallelujah. Afternoon, everyone. Let's stand all across this place today. I know it's a little odd for those of us that usually hear at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning, but we're still here to worship God today. Amen, amen. Just a couple of things we want to make you aware of. As you see, our front foyer, if you're a guest here, our front foyer is being remodeled. So if you do need to use the restrooms, we have guest services on either side that can direct you to the right location. Amen. If you have children here, 11 and under, we do have Sunday school in the back. So you could take them to the back if you feel well, if you feel open to do that. Amen. We just came to worship God today and have a little fun, a little fellowship. Amen. So if we could, let's just get our minds focused right now. Lord, we welcome you into this place today, God. We're so grateful that you love us. We're so thankful, God, of all that you've done for us. Meet with us today, God, as we give you glory and as we give you honor and as we give you praise. There's none beside you. There's none like unto you, O great God. And we worship you in this place this morning. Welcome in this place, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's worship together.
Put your hands together in this place. Hallelujah.
Wandering into the night,
yes.
Wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this bag of bones.
Yes.
And I tried with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of rope, I met a man I didn't know. And he told me that I was not alone.
He picked me up, he turned me around. On solid ground, I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart, he changed my name, forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God.
Deny what I see. Got no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends. Burden and bitterness, you can just keep it moving. No, you ain't welcome here. From now till
another one. I am free, I am free, oh, I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free, I am free, I am free. Say,
hell lost another one. I am free,
yes,
I am free, I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free, I am free.
Yeah.
me up. He's turned me around. He raised my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior. Because He healed my heart. He changed my name. Forever free. I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior.
Get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up, woo! Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Say,
get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave. Chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer. It's just a blessing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. Come on, sing this with us. I am free. Praise the Lord! Praise!
are stilled at the mention of his name. They'll say, my God is still the same as the walls. If they still fall at the mighty sound of praise, they'll say, my God is still the same. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail?
Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Yes.
When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change?
Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Still the same as the grave. If it was strong enough to keep hope in its chains, it'll say, God is still the same. Yeah.
When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Yes.
When did change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control.
Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Stop proving my God is in control.
Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control.
Sovereign One, I rest in your plan. Woo! From the depth to the dawn, you were there. Your promise is strong, and I will trust with all that I am. Jesus, Jesus, oh, how I need you. You stay the same. You are good in your ways. Jesus, Jesus, oh, how I need you. You are enough. All my trust is in you. My soul and know every thought, love so great but never too far. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Through the storm, you're the calm. In every war, you've already won. Life secure in your
impossible. I
Jesus. Hallelujah. What a great presence of the Lord in this place. God bless you this morning. You may be seated. Amen. Look around at all the guests and visitors we have today. We're so thankful you came to be with us on Friends and Family Day. Let's give them a hand clap of appreciation. Amen. Hallelujah. If our ushers could come, we're going to wait upon you for afternoon tithing and offering. Opportunity to give back to the Lord through our giving. We've been blessed. I don't know about you, but I've been blessed. God's been so good to me. I've got more than I deserve. I've been blessed beyond what I should be blessed, but I'm thankful for God who's given me those blessings so I can give back to His kingdom and for His purpose. Lord, we thank You for the opportunity we have to give this morning. We ask You to bless the gift and the giver in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you as you give. Just a couple quick announcements. We're so glad you all have come to be with us today on Friends and Family Day. After the service, as you know, we'll have some food, fun, and games. We've got hamburgers, hot dogs, hayride, face painting, bounce houses, candy rain, a bonfire. So a lot of stuff going on. So we're so glad that you came to join us with that. That will be in the back of the building immediately following service. And at the end of the service, we'll give you some more direction on where to go. But we're so glad you're here. This is not our normal schedule. Normally on Sundays, we have service at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. But we did it so you could be here today. And we're glad that you showed up. Amen. Amen. Our Wednesday night service usually at 7:30 on Wednesday night. We have youth every Friday night. So if you like to find a church, if you're looking for a church to get plugged into, we're here for you whenever you can come and join with us. Amen. Hallelujah. So very thankful. Our praise team's going to come back and sing one more song, then we're going to hear the word, and then we can get the food. We're just thankful and grateful that you came to worship with us. Let God do a work in your life today. Let's lay everything out of our minds for the next 30 minutes, and let's just get focused on what God has for you today. God bless you.
Can we stand all across this place? We're going to go into worship one more time.
We will not be shaken, we will not be moved, for the Lord is beside us, with Him we cannot lose. Though the shadow surrounds us, we will fear no evil, we'll trust in the Lord with our hearts, and in Your joy we will dwell forever. Though the night may seem weary, joy is coming, coming, coming in the morning. All praise to King Jesus, 'cause I know joy is coming. Yes, joy is coming. Shaken.
We will not be moved.
We will not be moved. For the Lord is beside us.
With Him we cannot lose.
With Him we cannot lose.
Though the shadow surrounds us.
The shadow surrounds us.
We will fear no evil.
We will fear no evil.
We'll trust in the Lord.
We'll trust in the Lord with our hearts, and in Your joy we will dwell forever.
Joy is coming. Woo! Come on, can you put your hands together like this? Woo! This is my favorite part of the song. It says, your light can drown out darkness and bring our joy to life. We won't submit to sorrow. Our joy is coming in the morning. Woo! Yes! In the morning. Come on, sing it with us. Your light.
Your light can drown out darkness and bring our joy to life. We won't submit to sorrow. Our joy is coming in the morning.
Come on, we won't submit to sorrow.
In the morning.
Come on, see your light.
Your light can drown out darkness and bring our joy to life. We won't submit to sorrow. Our joy is coming in the morning.
It's coming in the morning.
In the morning.
Come on, one more time, see your light.
Your light can drown out darkness and bring our joy to life. We won't submit to sorrow. Our joy is coming. Weary.
Joy is
coming in the morning.
Come on, do you believe that?
All praise to King Jesus.
I know
joy is coming. Jesus, 'cause I know joy is coming. Yes, joy is coming.
Joy is coming.
Well, clap your hands and give God a shout. Joy is coming. I don't know what kind of hell you might be going through right now, but joy is on the way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. You may be seated for a minute. If this is your first time to ever be at the Pentecostals of Gainesville, would you just slip your hands up real quick? Thank you so much. Look at this. If this is your first time to ever be in a Pentecostal service, slip your hand up. Oh, yes, 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 yes. You've survived this far. You've gotten further than most. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Now, you know, on these special days like this, we trick you a little bit because we let you sleep in. Church is at 3, but on a real Sunday, we're here at 10 and 6. Today, I'm going to preach real short because that's a trick, too. We got food out there. I walked in. I smelled that grill going. I was like, Lord, help us today. Amen. Thank you for being here. Let me just kind of go over a couple of things. I appreciate Brother Strickland making a few announcements again. As you can tell, we're in the middle of a remodel, but we didn't want to cancel Friends Day because of that. And so we appreciate you working with us and around that. We do have restrooms around the facilities. There's people on these hallways that can help direct you there. So thank you so much for being very patient with that. We're hoping to get a little more money. We ran out of money. We can't finish the trim. And so if anybody wants to sponsor a trim, let me know. We can get you that. I think paint's $30 a gallon. We would greatly, greatly appreciate that. You will love our remodel when it's over, and we're doing some stuff out front that's just going to be really nice, and I think it'll be a blessing, not just to our local church family, but I think it'll be a blessing to our community. I want to say this is a couple of weeks ago, this church honored my wife and I for Pastor Appreciation, and October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we thank you for that. But we have three active daughter works in our church, and we're about to launch a fourth one here in just a few months. So I wanted today to give honor to Brother and Sister Haney. They are our pastor at our daughter work in Lake City. Brother and Sister Quinones. Brother and Sister Quinones, they're our pastor of our Spanish daughter work. Brother and Sister Strickland, they're our pastor of our Alachua daughter work. And then Brother and Sister Dickerson will be the pastor of our Newberry daughter work. And so we want to give them honor and thank them for helping us launch churches and doing our part to reach as many people as we can. And so if you're here from Lake City, there's a great church in Lake City. We're planning a church in Alachua. Right now we're just meeting once a month, but we're getting ready to go weekly. And if you're around Newberry, we'll have another one coming there in April of next year. And so we would love to get you connected there. And, of course, we would love for you to come back and be with us anytime. As Rose Strickland said, Sunday mornings at 10, Sunday nights at 6, and Wednesday night at 7:30. I want to thank our praise team. Can we make some noise for our musicians and our praise team leading us in worship? I think we have some of the best musicians and singers in all the world. We have a choir, we have a youth choir, we have a children's choir, and this Christmas season, we are going to be hosting for the first time, since we've been here anyhow, a Christmas concert. We are going to have a banquet too, but we're going to be doing a Christmas concert, and that is going to be on Friday night, December the 9th at 7:30. And I want you to come to that, but here's what I'm asking you to do. You need to register for that on Eventbrite. We will be go to our social media pages. We'll make all that available to you. And you get to pick your seat where you want to sit in the concert. So if you're bringing your family and friends with you, you just go reserve your seats. It's free. Doesn't cost you anything. We're just going to make sure you have the seat where you want to sit. And so for all of you good POG people who says, that's my pew, you better get on there and register because it may be somebody else's pew. On Friday night, but we are believing the house is going to be full, and we're going to bring a little bit of good news in the Christmas season. How many knows this world could use a little good news? Amen. So in a Pentecostal church, we stand up a lot. We especially stand up for the reading of the Word. So I want you to stand. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Judges chapter 2, or you can follow along on the screen as we're getting get you ready there, get that up. To all of our guests that are here, thank you so, so very much. Donna, what's the name of your place you work? Alachua Family Eye Care. The owner of that, his wife is here. So this sermon is brought to you by Alachua Family Eye Care. If you need any eye care, then why don't you see our friends at Alachua? How did I do? Good? Okay, fair enough. I'll give you some offering envelopes, and if you get any customers, just send a little bit my way, all right? To all of our guests, thank you. Chris, thank you for being here with your boys. I appreciate that so very, very much. Amen. Now, I'm not going to preach long today, but I'm going to preach strong today. Okay, I'm not going to mince my words. I'm going to try to help us, encourage us a little bit today. Judges chapter 2, verse 10. And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers. In other words, that's King James language, for they died. And there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. So I want you to understand this. When your life is over, somebody else will step up. Amen? None of us are irreplaceable. None of us are as powerful as we think we are. And so one generation died, but there rose up another generation. Just the only unique thing about this generation is they did not know the Lord, nor did they know anything about his works. I would say this verse might be being fulfilled in our midst right now. There is a generation coming up that does not know God. I am thankful for us that do, but it is very important that we leave something to the next generation, more than money, more than land, more than things of this world. We need to leave the truth to the next generation. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. I know many of you probably have heard that Pentecostals have some really different beliefs and doctrines. One of our beliefs is that we believe it's a sin for women to make coffee because the Bible says Hebrews and not Shebrews. And so just tough crowd. Where's my drummer at? Da-dum-tsh. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. I can't go to that church then. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. This is more than just Friends Day. This is family and Friends Day. Noah saved his family. He saved his house, by which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is by faith. Now, I'm going to announce my title. It is not going to make any sense, none whatsoever. I don't know that it's going to make any sense when I'm done. I'm going to try, but don't leave just yet, okay? I want to talk to you for a few minutes on the porcupine's dilemma. Yeah, you don't think it's going to make sense either. I get it. The porcupine's dilemma. If you think you might help me preach, shout amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Let's do a little survey real quick. Another thing in a Pentecostal church, we believe in class participation, so a little bit of noise isn't going to offend nobody. How many of you have a cat as a pet? All right, there's all our little cat lovers. How many of you have a dog as a pet? Okay. What about a fish? We got a few fish folks around here. Maybe a bird. We've got some bird lovers here. I'm going to ask this next one, but then I'm going to pray for you, and I'm going to rebuke the devil out of you. Any snake owners here? Right there. Would somebody lay hands on him right there? We need to get that devil out of him. Bodie, I rebuke it in Jesus' name. What about a raccoon? We got some raccoon lovers around this church. We even have a man in our church with a pet skunk. Yeah, we do. He named his pet skunk Jimmy Toney. I have real issues with that. Nobody has seen Wayne in a few weeks. You know why? Because I have issues with him naming his skunk. How many has a porcupine as a pet? Anybody know anybody with a porcupine as a pet? Not too many people are running to Petco to pick up porcupines for their kids. Allow me to bore you for a few moments with a little need-to-know information. The North American porcupine is a member of the rodent family that has around 30,000 quills attached to his body. Each quill can be driven in an enemy, and the enemy's body heat will cause the microscopic barb to expand and become more firmly embedded in whatever the quill is stuck in. The wounds can fester, and the more dangerous ones can affect vital organs and can actually be fatal. A porcupine can kill you. Because of this, the porcupine is not generally regarded as a lovable animal. The Latin name for porcupine literally means irritable back. I guess so. Irritable back. Books and movies celebrate almost every conceivable animal, not just dogs and cats and horses, but pigs with the movie Babe, spiders with Charlotte's Webs, dolphins with Flipper, bears, Gentle Ben, and even killer whales, Free Willy. But I don't know of any famous porcupines. As a general rule, porcupines have two methods for handling with relationships. They withdraw or they attack. Not much in between. They either withdraw or they attack. They either try to find a tree to hide or immediately stick out their quills and they're ready to fight. And because of these traits, they are generally known as solitary animals. Wolves run in packs. Sheep huddle in flocks. We speak of a herd of elephants, even a murder of crows. But there is no special name for a group of porcupines because they most always travel alone. But in the fall of every year, the porcupine's thoughts turns to love and the next generation. But love in the world of porcupines can turn into a sticky situation. It can be very risky to love in the porcupine world. And so the porcupine's dilemma is, how do I get close without getting hurt? And that's probably most of our dilemma as well. How do I get close without getting hurt? How do I get close to the church without getting hurt? How do I get close to God without my prayers not being answered and me getting hurt? How do I draw nigh unto the Lord and not get hurt? Because each of us carries around our own little arsenal of barbs and quills. Things such as rejection or condemnation, resentment, anger, selfishness, envy, and the list can go on and on. And as a general rule, as people, we have two methods for handling relationships. We either withdraw or we attack. We either fight with our spouse or with the kids or with the boss or with the neighbors or with whosoever will, or we just withdraw ourselves and say, I don't need you and you don't need me, and so I'll just go live by myself and I'll just build up walls around me and I'll never ever have fellowship with anybody again. And I'm afraid if we're not careful, we will forfeit the next generation because we're too afraid to drop our defenses and stop withdrawing and stop attacking and actually start investing in our families and start preparing the next generation. Hear me, and I'm going to shift gears, but the porcupine's dilemma is that they have to be willing to put down their defenses, quit withdrawing, quit attacking, and actually think about the next generation, or else they will go extinct. And so on this Family and Friends Day, I wanted to preach to some families today and tell you that you have withdrew long enough. You have been the Lone Ranger long enough. You have been attacked and you have been defensive long enough. It's time to get our families back in the name of the Lord. It's time to get off the fringe. It's time to quit being casual. It's time to put away that simple little golf clap that you call worship every once in a while. The world is trying to destroy the family unit. But we cannot raise up another generation that will not know the Lord. Our greatest dilemma is to make sure we're focusing on the next generation. I want your kids to have a relationship with God. I want your grandbabies to have a relationship with God. I want to have such a relationship with God that my daughter, my son-in-law, and thankfully now my future grandchildren will survey all the other options and ultimately say, I want a relationship with the God of my father. Countless times in scripture does it say that they did as their father did, and nothing has changed. Every parent in this house ought to make up your mind that you're going to put your pride on the back burner, you're going to put your career on the back burner, you're going to put your stubbornness on the back burner, and you're going to teach your kids how to pray, and you're going to teach your kids how to worship, and you're going to teach your kids how to win people to God, and how to be good citizens in a very crazy world. It's time to put down our defenses and stop withdrawing and start thinking about the next generation. Somebody shout amen. Amen. So in Noah's day, people lived by their conscience. They did what was right in their own eyes. You can't live like that for too long until the enemy introduces compromise to you. And compromise always contaminates. It always contaminates. The reason why this is so important to us is because Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 37, he says, as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. So this teaches me that the end of days will be very much like that before the flood in Noah's day. And the Bible says this about Noah's day, Genesis chapter number 6, verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he made man on the earth. It grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I've created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repented me that I had made them. It looked horrible in Noah's day. It didn't look like anybody was trying to live for God in Noah's day. Only the bad was getting the press in Noah's day. And Jesus said, it'd be a lot like that when the Lord is ready to come back. But it wasn't all bad in Noah's day. Let's keep reading. Verse 8. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. There is something special about godly people in an ungodly world. I'll take it a step further. One godly person can change the entire world. Oh, that you didn't believe that. So anytime a preacher feels like you didn't believe what he said, he says it again. He says it louder. One godly person can change the entire world. No wonder the devil's trying to keep us ungodly. No wonder the devil's trying to keep the church carnal, worldly, devilish, sensual, half in, half out, lukewarm. No one half on, half off. No wonder the devil's trying to keep us so messed up, because one godly person can change the world. One godly husband can change a family. One godly wife can change a home. One godly person on your job can turn that thing upside down. One godly person can start a revival that would turn this city upside down. No wonder the devil tries to keep us carnal, because that type of church couldn't affect the atmosphere of an inch, much less of the world. And not only can a godly person change the world, but they can also change heaven. God was ready to destroy the whole earth, but one person found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And when he did, the Bible says that God changed his mind. He was ready to wipe off the whole earth. And he said, no, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to now give them a chance, a way of escape. Let me encourage you today and remind you, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be now. And most of us always just preach that verse, the bad, the bad, the bad, the bad. But I'm going to flip it on you today. And I'm going to tell you, the Bible says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be. And he found grace in somebody in that day, and he's going to find grace in somebody today. So I know the world is bad. I know the world is crazy. I know the world has lost its mind. But I'm looking at some people today that God sees grace in, and his grace is greater than the craziness of this world. I said, his where sin abounds, the grace of God does much more abound. It pays to live right. It pays to live right. It pays to have a relationship with God. Even if everybody else is in the wrong. Even if everybody else is backsliding. Even when others are doing what's right in their own eyes. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, and we can find grace as well. Can I preach to you today that Noah may not have saved a lot of people? He may not have had the biggest church in town, but he did save his family. And we've got to get our eyes back on our families. We must save our families. The best thing that could ever happen is for our houses to become houses of hope, is for us to learn that my house can make a difference. Let's go to church as a family. Let's come to the altar as a family. Let's clap our hands as a family. If you're going to teach them how to play ball, teach them how to worship. If you're going to teach them how to work, teach them how to be faithful to the house of God. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. I don't care if Caitlin and Caleb is ever rich. I don't care how popular they are. I don't care if they're well known in this organization or any organization. I just want them to walk in truth and live for God with all of their heart, their soul, their mind, and their strength. And if your kids are not in church, let me encourage you today. I want you to get a hold of hope and faith, and I want you to believe God's going to bring your kids back to that saving knowledge. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not. I feel that in the Holy Ghost. I'm speaking revival over your family in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every curse over your families in the name of Jesus. I rebuke alcohol. I rebuke drugs. I rebuke marijuana. I rebuke pornography. I rebuke every vice. I rebuke every addiction that's trying to destroy your family. You have been brought to the kingdom for such a time as this. Our families are under attack. I'm not trying to be rude. I'm not trying to be crazy. Well, I am that, but I'm not trying to be. But our families are under attack. We're living in a failing society. Parents are failing. Teen pregnancy has increased 500% in the last 30 years. Suicide among young people has increased 300%. Divorce has increased 700% in the last 100 years. In many homes, both parents work. Television, social media, streaming platforms are raising the next generation. You don't think Disney knows that? You don't think they know what they're doing when they're peddling stuff to your kids? They know you're not paying attention to it. You're too busy. I'm not trying to beat you up. It's just the fact. In many homes, discipline is non-existent, and therefore a lack of respect is overwhelming. It seems as if the public school system is failing. It's moving toward tolerance and relativism. They call for diversity, tolerance. They're rewriting history books to be politically correct rather than to be truthful. There seems to be more interest in teaching sex education and gender identity than there is reading, writing, and arithmetic. The entertainment industry is failing. Hollywood pumps the idea of premarital sex and alcohol into our kids' mind. Music and movies are full of profanity, revenge, lewd lyrics, scenes that are just appalling. Homosexuality is as normal there as prayer is here. And here's what's so sad, is if CNN or Fox News were reporting this, some of you would listen to it. You would have validity in that. If the White House was saying this, many would believe it. If Trump said it, many would retweet it. And God knows if the CDC said it, we would definitely believe it. Well, I tried to get some of them to come, but they were busy today. So God sent you a Holy Ghost-filled preacher to tell you. And it's time we turn our attention to the next generation. They need godly examples. They do not need to see a perfect mother. They do not need to see a perfect father. They just need to see somebody that's trying to live for God and make an effort. It will go a long way to the next generation. When the Lord told Moses to go let his people go from Egypt, one of the compromises that Pharaoh gave Moses when he was trying to negotiate the release from Egypt was this. He said, you can go, just let us keep your kids. You go, you let me keep the next generation enslaved in Egypt. You go to freedom, you let me stay here. You let your kids stay here. That's why Judges 2 and 10 is such a frightening verse, that there was a generation that rose up after them which knew not the Lord. They had no knowledge of the Lord. They had no knowledge of the works of the Lord. No one had testified in a long time. No one had a home Bible study in a long time. The ways of the Lord just kind of died out. Somewhere, somebody did not convey the importance or the imperative of all that God was and is and of all that God had done. Somewhere there was a breakdown in Deuteronomy chapter number 6. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. And thou shalt teach them diligently, listen, unto your children. And shalt talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you get up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house, and on thy gates. According to this passage, you get it in your heart and then you take it to your home. I want something to get into your heart today that you'd be willing to take to your house today. No wonder Joshua said, as for me and my house, as for this generation and the next generation, it's time to make sure that when we're dead and gone, that there's still a one God, Jesus' name, Holy Ghost filled, tongue talking church that your kids can go to, that your grandkids can go to. We want to still make sure there is a holiness, that there is a separated from the world church that is still preaching the same gospel that's been preached for 2,000 years. So the porcupine's dilemma is very similar to ours. We withdraw or we fight, or we put up our defenses and we quit running and we turn our attention to the next generation. Porcupines don't always want to be alone. In the late fall, a young porcupine's thoughts turned to love and to the next generation. And miracle of miracles takes place, and relationship does happen even for those irritable backed porcupines. Porcupines learn to keep their barbs to themselves, and they learn that withdrawal is not always the best way, and they figure out how to get together long enough to make sure that another generation will come along. A man by the name of David Costello wrote, and I quote, in an image too wonderful to be made up, male and female porcupines, there's a mouthful right there, may remain together for several days before mating. They may touch paws and even walk on their hind feet in the so-called, listen, dance of the porcupine. So how do porcupines procure the next generation? They pull in their quills and they learn how to dance. And the best thing we can do for the next generation is to quit fighting with one another, quit withdrawing and running away from the church every time something doesn't go the way we want, and just learn how to dance, learn how to worship, learn how to pray. I know some of you said this is your first time here, but listen, it's just normal for us Pentecostals to worship God. When you have the revelation of where we come from, there's people around here that's been in jail and prison, that's been on drugs and alcohol. Their life was headed to hell, but God reached down and His blood covered them and forgave them and put their feet onto a solid path. They can't help but praise the Lord. Thank God for worship. Thank God for worship. Thank God that's how you're going to keep the next generation going. Is keep your mind on Jesus. For the hour cometh and now is when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. We got to learn how to worship. We got to quit withdrawing. We got to quit attacking. When there's an issue, just come on to the house of God and let God help us through that issue, because that's how we preserve the next generation. Our doctrine cannot die. Our dance cannot die. Our distinctives cannot die. So instead of me fighting and instead of me running, I'm just going to come together and I'm going to learn to dance. And I'm going to worship God in the good times and I'm going to worship God in the bad times. And I'm going to quit letting the devil talk me into hiding myself and running my family this way and running my family. I'm just going to say we're going to get anchored in the ways of God, in the word of God, and come hell or high water, we're going to live for God, and God's going to see us through every situation. And I promise you, there'll be a child that will rise up and call you blessed. There will be a grandchild. There'll be a great-grandchild that looks at your picture and go, I never met him, but thank God they broke the cycle. Thank God they broke the cycle. Thank God somebody taught them a Bible study. Thank God they went to a friend's day. Thank God they got baptized in Jesus' name. We cannot afford to lose another generation. Let's all stand. As our custom is, we always give people a chance to pray. And we've got a lot of great things planned here in just the next few minutes after service, and we want you to stay for that. But it would not be right if we tried to get together and not give somebody a chance to pray. God's word is God's law. His word is his will. I want to help somebody today. Long before there were the Ten Commandments, no other gods before me, no graven images, don't take the Lord's name in vain, keep the Sabbath day holy, honor your father and your mother, do not commit murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not covet. Those are the Ten Commandments. Long before those commandments, it was somewhat simpler. Actually, it could be reduced to one command found in Genesis chapter 1. God just looked at Adam and Eve and said, reproduce. Just reproduce. What are you saying? Think about the next generation. Do something for the next generation. The porcupine's dilemma is really our dilemma as well. We've got to put down our defenses. We've got to quit running and hiding. And we've got to consecrate our lives so that the next generation will know about your God and the ways of your God. If you want to see your family saved, if you want to see your children saved, if you want to see a revival amongst your own kind, hear me when I tell you, quit hiding, quit fighting. It's time to trust God. It's time to surrender everything to Him. If you're here this morning, you have never repented of your sins. And maybe some of the things I mentioned while preaching, some of the addictions, and maybe they've got a hold of you and you would like freedom from that. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You don't have to wonder about that. He will give you rest. He said, cast all your care upon me because I care for you. You walked in with heavy burdens. You walked in with things of this world just pulling at you. And you know I'm telling the truth because for years you have run and hid. Now, if we were to be honest, some of us has fought with more people than we care to talk about. But God sent a preacher here to tell you, put the quills down. Quit running. Let's think about your children. Let's think about your grandchildren. Anything you do for God will become a memorial to the next generation. Anything that you give up for God will become a testimony. Listen, your family don't even have to understand it. Just tell them, hey, I'm drawing nigh to God. I know Daddy used to be like this, and I used to act like this, and Grandpa used to do this, and Grandma used to do this. But listen, we're changing. I'm not even telling you to change, but we're changing. Make a statement, because anything you give up for God now will make deposits into the next generation. Oh, I wish I'd have had a pile of rocks
because the Lord told him, said, I want you to build that altar, and you take those stones out from that Jordan River where you walked across on dry land. You get those stones and you build a memorial, so when the next generation comes by, and they'll say, what do those stones mean? You tell them, oh, let me testify about what God did. God is urging some of you to take some rocks out of some very nasty things that God's brought you through. Take a rock and build an altar and build a memorial. So one day when your children says, what does that mean? You can say, oh, let me tell you, there was a time that your mom and daddy was this close. There was a time that we thought about giving up. There was a time that we were going to go a separate way. There was a time that your dad was on drugs and alcohol. There was a time that I was probably going to spend the rest of my life in prison, but God walked by. Now, I used to fight that, and I used to argue against that, and I used to run and hide every time a preacher starts preaching that. But you listen to me. The porcupine's dilemma is most of us Pentecostals' dilemmas too. Just run and hide. Run and hide. So I want to help somebody today. You don't have to run and hide anymore. I want you to bow your head, lift your hands up all over this place. And I don't plan on dwelling here long. I know we've got a lot of activities, and I want to respect that, and I want to meet. My family wants to meet as many of you as possible. But I'm just wondering, if I preach to somebody today, and you feel the Holy Ghost, you feel the Spirit of God just knocking on your heart's door right now. It may be your first time here. You may be a regular here. You may be a saint here. But you feel the Holy Ghost knocking on your door. Would you step out of your pew? Would you make that little walk down to this altar right now? Lift your hands up toward heaven and ask God to forgive you and ask God to help you and ask God to deliver you. You do not have to carry on that curse. That generational curse can be broken today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Come on, with your hands raised. Lord, would you pull and draw upon someone's heart right now? Would you let some soul that's been being attacked from hell find safety and hope in this house right now? We have fought long enough. We have hid long enough. We're coming out of hiding. Our families have been attacked long enough. It's time for us to turn our attention to the next generation. I wonder if I got some mamas and daddies that would say, hey, we're going to do better at my house. We're going to do everything we can to reach the next generation. If you're here, maybe you could take your kids by the hand, step out of into that aisle and come toward this front and let the Holy Ghost just minister to you for a few minutes. This doesn't make you join the church. We're not going to invade your space. We just want you to give you an opportunity to pray. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, touch every family. God, you see every situation. You know every issue. God, let the love that I feel in this room just envelop around people right now. Draw their hearts right now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand.
Come on, you've hid long enough.
And your family and your children.
It's the next generation.
And their children.
I want my children to live right.
Be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family and your children. And their children. The children,
you,
may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family.
Come on, we've got to protect
children.
And preserve.
Children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Oh, amen. Amen. Amen.
Come all over this place. Back on your radar.
Amen. Amen. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and you're going, and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. He is for you.
Thank you, Jesus. Can we clap our hands and give the Lord praise? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, if you're here and you've never been baptized in Jesus' name, we would love for you to take that next step, that obey that next commandment to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Or maybe if you're not ready for that, maybe you'd want a Bible study to know more about that. We would love to be able to do that. Brother Winston up here on the platform, he would be more than happy to talk to you about baptism. Man, we got a great crowd here, a lot of guests. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Church, can we make all of our guests feel welcome? We're so thankful they came. Now, for all of you that are here and you're not part of this church, this is the best church in the whole world with the best people that you'll ever meet in your life. It's a very multi-generational, multicultural church that just loves God and loves this community. And a lot of times we love one another. And so it's just a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful thing. Okay, our foyer's all shut down, so it's hard to exit. Well, you can't exit back that way. So we got these two exits here. We have a lot of things set up in the back. We have food for you. You can just go to the very back. There'll be people directing you. You'll see a lot of us wearing different T-shirts. My church, make my church your church. Or other shirts that says encourage one another. Got family and friends day. All of those people can help answer any question you have to get you where you are. If you have to leave, I understand, but we'd love for you to spend some time with. We've got a bonfire. It's going to be going out back. Food, fellowship, hayride. It's just going to be a great, great day of fellowship. Amen. Would you find somebody you don't know real quick and just introduce yourself to them and say, hey, maybe next time you ought to bring a mint with you. Yeah, tell them, say, next time bring a mint to church. God bless you. You're dismissed in the